Hello. Inspired by Ben Ida's video series about an 8-bit computer on breadboards, I built my own version. I've made some extensions to his design and so I ended up in using 30 breadboards. Power distribution was the most challenging aspect during build time. The other thing was noise on the clock line. In this video, I want to show how I managed to get around those problems and why my system is already overclocked at a speed of 1.8 MHz. The first thing I checked was an estimate of the power consumption of the complete build. There is a section on the data sheets of each chip which tells us about the power a chip needs while connected to power. Ben Ida uses the LS low power Schottky series. A look into the datasheet for a typical LS chip tells us it needs around 10 milliamps or at 5 volts. That doesn't seem much at first glance, but my build consists of almost 100 chips. That sums up to about 1 amps, and at 5 volt that means your system takes around 5 watts. That is way more than a typical USB charger can provide. The solution lies in using a different TDL chip series, namely HC or HCT. I use the HCT type because it's fully compatible with LS chips and works in combination with LS, HC and of course HCT chips. These chips have a much smaller supply current. They still need some extra current during switching time, and the other parts on the boards like the LEDs or the peripheral devices also ask for the current, but all the 100 chips just being connected only take as little as 10 milliamps or 50 milliwatts. To power up my breadboard computer, I use a standard USB charger and the Eligo power supply module, which also has a power switch. I put the power feeding point closer to the center of the breadboard computer and lead paired wires to the lower part of the breadboard, and of course there are also wires to the upper parts of the breadboard computer, but this is only for the left-hand side. The right-hand side has its own connection, so there is one for the upper part of the breadboards on the right-hand side and a few more for the lower part of the breadboard computer. But there is an additional wire on the left-hand side that is directly connected to the power supply. It's here, and this wire leads directly to the keyboard because the keyboard always resets whenever the power drops below 4.5 volts. So in total I divided my breadboard computer into 6 separate sections which all have direct connection to the power supply, and so all the sections have enough power to operate safely. Although the system works stable, the solution is not perfect. Right behind the feeding point there is enough power, so 4.6 is not optimal, but it's inside the specs. But if we go further ahead, you see the power drops just above 4 volts, and that is not inside the specs. To prevent power fluctuation, I added those 570 microfarad electrolyte capacitors in every second rail and also on all the feeding points on the sections. And for higher frequency fluctuations, I added those 100 nanofarad capacitors on every rail. And one thing I found out was that the clock line was very noisy, and to prevent that I added a 100 nanofarad capacitor to every chip that is connected to the clock line, and These are decoupling capacitors that have direct connection from the 5-volt to the ground line. Unfortunately, the 555 timer chip is especially noisy, and you see a lot of capacitors around the chip to pretend that noise. And the first capacitor is of course just for the frequency, so this is a low ceramic capacitor to have a high speed clock. And the next capacitor is connected between 5 volts and ground and is for high frequency fluctuations in the current. The next is that 1 microfarad electrolyte capacitor that is for low frequency fluctuation in current and was mentioned in the datasheet for the CMOS variant of that 555 timer chip. And the last one is connected to pin 5 and was already in Ben-Ida series. And this is a direct connection to the comparators in the 555 timer. If one takes a closer look at the system clock cycle, you can see that the high and the low state divide into different phases, whereas the low part divides into the microstep counter up, that is the part when the step counter is counting up. And then the second part, that is when the control lines are set by the EEPROM, so that is when the EEPROM access has finished and the control lines are set. And then the third state is when the system prepares for the next state. That is when the addition is done by the ALU or when the memory access in RAM has been done. The high phase is divided into the latch of the system state, so that is all that what was prepared in the step ahead, so that all the registers get their values, or when a memory write was requested that the byte is written into memory. And the last phase is the instruction decode, so that if a new instruction was latched, that instruction will be translated to an address in the microcode EEPROMs. So for phase A, which is the step counter up, I look into the data sheet and find that the CP2QN, so from clock pulse to output, there is a number of times, and I pick the one that is for 4.5 volts and for 25 degrees, and it tells me I take about 37 nanoseconds. For the access time of the control EEPROM, which is phase B, I just take the easy way and look at the marketing part of the datasheet, and that tells me the EEPROM will take 150 nanoseconds. Now we have the times for the first two phases, phase A and phase B. And for phase C, the things get more complicated because it depends on the control line setting and it depends on the schematic you have. In my case, the longest signal path I could find was adding a value that is from an absolute memory address. And so I start with the schematic and try to find out what times were needed. This is a sector of my memory schematics, and you can see the control line ME coming in on the upper right side of the schematic, and you can see the signal path. It's going through 2 OR gates, then going to the RAM chip, and the data from the RAM chip goes through that bus transceiver to the data bus. If you know all the chips that lie on your signal path, you can look up their switching times in the respective data sheets. And in the case of this memory access, I made that and put all the data in my spreadsheet program. And in fact, there is an additional chip right before the first ME is available, because there is a demultiplexer behind my control EEPROM, and there are several chips in the ALU that do the addition and that pick up the data for the flex, and so the total time is quite below 500 nanoseconds. Now that we have all the times for the three phases during the low clock, we can sum all these times up and find out how long the low phase of the clock is. But there is an additional delay, because to have the step counter counting up, the system clock has to be inverted, and that inverted chip is the very first step in the low phase of the system clock. So I put all the data in my spreadsheet program again and come to the data of 632 nanoseconds for the low clock time. A similar calculation can be done for the high time of the clock, and one can see that the latch time is about 32 nanoseconds for a 3770 chip, and the time to decode the instruction is about 105 nanoseconds, and that makes a total of 137 nanoseconds for the high phase of the clock. With all this data, we can calculate what our optimal clock would look like. Now that we know the complete cycle time, which is 769 nanoseconds, and we know that we need an optimal duty cycle of 18%, that means 18% of the complete cycle time is the high time of the clock. That makes a frequency at optimal duty cycle of 1.3 megahertz, but a typical clock, like an oscillator, has a 50% duty cycle, and so we have to stay with the longer time, which is the low cycle time. And in this case, with a 50% duty cycle, the optimal clock would be 791 kilohertz, or about 0.8 megahertz. In fact, my system runs a little bit faster, so it's about 1.8 megahertz, and I have a duty cycle of about 32%. Usually the duty cycle of a 555 timer is higher than 50%, but I added an inverter behind the clock, and so the duty cycle is lower. If I take this data and put that into the same calculation but the other way around, so I take my frequency of 1770 kilohertz and my duty cycle of about 33%, I get a cycle time of 565 nanoseconds, and cycle high time, which is a third of this, it's 186 nanoseconds, and that leaves 379 nanoseconds for the low cycle time. That is a bit more than the half of the low cycle time that is required for being in this specification. But as you see, that what the specifications show is always the maximum value, and the typical values might be lower, and this is the reason for why my system runs stable, although I have it hardly overclocked. So that concludes my second video about my 8-bit breadboard computer. Again, feel free to comment. Thank you, and bye.